If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
In this episode of Mind Pump for 15 minutes, me and my beloved co-hosts have a fun discussion. We talk about
we're beloved.
Justin's chicken run.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's cardio.
I just run with the chickens.
We talk about household
like Rocky.
Chores and how...
Sal or Adam do any?
I'm the only one that does them now.
And you ever got your hands dirty?
And then, of course, we talk about keeping peace in the home. Hopefully, when this episode airs, we still have it.
Yeah.
Then we get
Don't
into the,
listen.
And we also mention our sponsor, Organifi. We talk about their green juice, which is actually delicious.
Can you use it for intra workouts to build hella muscle?
The inception workout.
Probably not, but it's still delicious. Anyhow, if you go to OrganifiShop.com, enter the code MINDPUMP, you'll get, I think it's 20% off.
It is.
Pretty much anything you want to get. Then we get into the questions. The first question was, how do we enjoy the holidays without compromising our health and fitness?
I just get really drunk.
Yeah, what do we do so that we don't leave the holiday looking like Santa? Next question was, what are our thoughts on intra-workout foods and drinks? If you think I made up that word intra-workout, I didn't. The supplement industry did. The next question was, what is our method for retaining information? So if we read something and we want to remember it so we can recite it on the show, do we just look it up on our Google phones?
Or marijuana does not help this. I have a chip in my head.
No, there are techniques, though, that will help you. Finally, what advice do we give a new gym manager with regards to training trainers? Should they just teach them all new exercise programming, or should they give them total freedom and have anarchy in the gym? Find out in this episode. Also, are you an athlete? Do you want to be a sexy athlete? Are you neither, but you want to be both? We offer the Sexy Athlete Bundle. This includes MAPS Aesthetic and MAPS Performance melded together. So it's basically two separate fitness programs that we've designed. One of them is called MAPS Aesthetic. It's designed to train stage presentation athletes like bodybuilders, physique competitors, people who are really concerned with getting symmetry to their physiques. Then we also have MAPS Performance, which is a program for athletic performance. So it's different in how they're programmed. But what we've done is we've taken both programs, which seem on two sides of the spectrum, and we've combined them and melded them so that we've created the Sexy Athlete Bundle, the aesthetics with the performance.
So you look good, but can you move good?
Exactly. And it's discounted massively because we've bundled them together. If you're interested in this program or you want to look at some of our other ones, go to mindpumpmedia.com. Can you tell us about the process of the chicken run that you, what do you call it, chicken prison? In your Insta
prison
story?
Yeah.
You built it all out.
I did. It took me like maybe 3 weekends.
Did you do that solo or did someone help you?
No, I just did it by myself.
Did that Han Solo, bro.
Yeah. Oh, Han Solo.
Pretty legit.
So what's going down with that? Like, first of all, well done. Construction.
Thank you, sir.
It's to keep him stop shitting on his deck, I think.
Yeah, man. I mean, that's honestly, it's that. And it was because I saw Courtney was trying to figure it out and she was like kind of looking online and looking at posts,
she was
and like
build
how to
it?
Set posts and all this kind of stuff, and I was just like, no, let me do it. You know?
She was gonna build it.
Yeah, I think she's really figured out how to
get
manipulate
you to
me.
Oh, dude, I already know what she does. It's the same thing Katrina does.
Like she totally gets like halfway there and like almost starts ordering it and all that. I'm like, whoa, 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 what are you doing?
Katrina does the same when there's something around the house that she wants done.
Yeah,
and like she keeps reminding me, like, hey, could you fix the light fixture, this and that? And I'm like, yeah, yeah, yeah.
All she has to do is start doing it.
Yeah, then she'll start doing it. And then I just know I feel like a
piece of... So you got to do what
you
I used
can't
to
be
do.
A man and sit down and watch your woman
you
change.
Do, you
like
gotta,
that.
I'm
like,
you gotta
are
do what
you
I used
serious?
To do.
Like you're building something and you're not involving me. Not gonna happen.
You got to do what I used to do. It's because you guys are your egos.
Of course, it's my ego, dude.
You got to do what I used to do.
I would never build a chicken run. Like I give two shits.
Do what I used to do, bro.
Salad powers them.
Yeah,
great job,
yeah.
Honey.
Oh yeah, that's nice,
oh, honey.
Thanks, honey.
Let me eat you a sweat rag.
Yeah, can you turn it down though? Like, don't do the drill so much. I can't watch TV. Yeah. Take it from me, the guy that's divorced. My method.
Solid advice.
My methods are effective.
Yeah. Indeed.
I was like, wow.
At being single.
I was like,
right?
Wow, look at her mow the lawn. That's pretty good.
Wow, you're really getting a lot of back sweat there.
Yeah. Take a nap.
Bro, I'll be the first to admit I'm worst around the house, man. I'm terrible at that stuff. I really am. I don't know what it is because as a kid we had all these chores, dude. I had fucking chores up the ass all the time, man. It was crazy.
Yeah,
my parents were smart. They had us to treat us like slaves. They had my sister and I cooking and cleaning. Like,
ooh, we
and
need some more workers
and vacuuming and mowing. Like,
you know, that popping them out.
That was, it was like their strategy. It was like, let's just have all these.
That's
kids.
That's a terrible strategy.
It was.
And how expensive children are.
Yeah,
you can hire someone for way less.
Yeah, I think that's what they weren't thinking. They
than
didn't
a child.
They didn't think it all the way through.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, they didn't think it.
Sometimes
all
I look at my kids. I'm like, damn.
Yeah,
you're expensive.
Yeah, all my paycheck goes.
Dad wants his new car.
Dad wants a new car.
Fucked.
My kids start doing. They started doing their chores now. My son will wash the dishes.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, and they make their bed every morning, which is pretty good. Way more than I ever did when I was at home.
Yeah, I get them doing as much as I can think of, you know. I'm
do
like,
you guys?
Hey, sweep this, wash my car.
So you did chores when you were a kid?
A lot.
And Justin, did you do chores when you were a kid?
All the time, yeah.
You did?
Yeah, but I was always going after the ones that were outside. So it was chopping wood, loading wood, stacking stuff, building things. You know, I was like always trying to get out of the house.
Because I did go to work with my dad and stuff, but in the house I did nothing. So you had to understand this is a culture. It's an old school Southern Italian culture where especially if you're a boy, your mom does, in especially if it has to do with in the house, your mom does everything for you. Like, I didn't even know how to open a bank account when I was 18 years old. Like, everything.
Yeah, it ruins you.
They do, and it did. Yeah. It ruined the fuck out of me. Yeah, like, totally. I wouldn't make my bed. I wouldn't clean my nothing. I wouldn't clean my clothes.
Well, my mom would want to, like, fight all my fights, you know, with, like, my teachers and everybody. Like, she'd come in like a bulldog, just, rah! I'm like, no. I would, like, selectively not tell her what happened, you know, some things at school. Because I know she would come in with, like, guns blazing.
Yes. I purposely wouldn't tell my mom shit because she would throw down.
Yeah.
So I had to be
my
careful.
Like that
I had to be very careful.
Now, when you got married, did that change at all, or because you married into an Italian woman, and she followed suit probably just like your mother did, I would assume.
It took me a while to really understand and learn, like, to do. I was like clueless, dude, like literally clueless.
Now, is this something that you
like? I didn't know how to wash a dish.
It's like so cute.
It's not. It's terrible.
It's not.
It's
actually
terrible.
It's not. I'm just saying.
You know what I used to do, though? This is what I used to do. When my mom would wash dishes, I still do to this day. If I eat over my mom's house, after dinner, she'll get up and she'll start like washing the dishes, and then maybe my sisters will help put stuff away. Now I help and put things away and try and wash. And of course, she swats me away. So then while she's washing dishes, I just kiss her and hug her while she does it. And she giggles. I squeeze the shit out of my mom.
So does this work with Jessica, or have you had to change?
No. I do a lot more now. I live there too. It's just a strange, it comes from the old world where people had their role. So it wasn't like my dad didn't do anything. My dad handled all the stuff that had to do with outside or the cars or the stereotypical like manly, you know, man stuff.
Right.
So they definitely both did a lot. It wasn't like, you know, one was lazy and one, you know, did all the stuff.
Right.
They both did.
It was like an agreement. Yeah.
They both did their roles. So that's where it kind of comes from. But today, like, you know, like I don't do my yard work. I mean, when I was married, I had a house and it was like, I just hired someone to do my lawn and do that kind of stuff. If I need the car fixed, I go pay someone. So it was strange. And now I take pride in it. The funny thing is, and this is really, really strange, I really enjoy doing shit around the house. Yeah. I actually enjoy it.
Really?
I actually enjoy doing laundry and dishes and stuff like that. I almost find it to be meditative and therapeutic. So like while I'm doing it, I'm thinking, or I don't know. It's very strange. It's interesting.
Mm.
Very, very interesting. But when I was a kid, yeah, no. No, but
now, was that something that it was just an easy transition for you? There was no growing pains that you went through from being a kid who didn't have to, who got all his shit done, and then you got into a marriage or got into now a relationship where you...
Bro, growing pains? What do you think? I mean,
that's what I'm fishing for.
I mean, it was a big struggle. It was a big struggle. It was towards the end of my marriage that I really started to...
When did you take ownership and realize it was partially your own fault, right?
That was partially my own fault?
Yeah.
When, later on, much, much later on, much later on. But there were, you know, I had my own resentment, so it was tough to see You know what I'm saying? Because you see what the other person isn't doing or whatever, or if they're being a dick or whatever. But no, I mean, now it's like I take pride in doing it, which is, it's very interesting because, again, I was brought up in that type of environment where my brother lived at home for so long, and it was funny because we would be at family functions, you know, and my brother's like, you know, he'd be, God, how old was he when he moved out? He was in his 20s for sure. He was making plenty of money. And people would be like, hey, when are you going to get your own house, dude? And he's like, why? He's like, I eat restaurant quality, like better than restaurant quality food. He's like, I don't have to clean anything. Free rent. And my mom would be right there and she'd be smiling like, yeah, he could stay as long as he wants. She was like, she'd be so happy. She would be so happy if he lived there until he got married. Like 45-year-old dude, she'd be so happy if he was there.
Oh, man. That's so funny.
Isn't it hilarious?
That is funny. I'm afraid for my mom, and my brother just moved back in with my mom. I'm afraid for the same thing because he's in his 20s right now. He came back from Colorado. My mom brought him in, and my mom's getting ready. She's engaged, and she has a marriage next year coming. So I'm like, you're crazy. What are you doing letting my 20-something-year-old brother move back in with you guys right now?
Damn.
And it moved in with a girlfriend, too.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I'm like, oh, man.
Sealing the deal.
You crazy. You guys are crazy. I send, like, a text message over to my mom's, you know, fiancé now, right? And check up on him, like, every 2 weeks. Hey, bro, how you doing over there? How you doing, my crazy-ass family over there? Oh, I'm good.
So what do you guys do around the house now? Do you guys do anything around the house
What are
now?
Your bad habits? That like, what do you not do that you know you should probably do?
I think
let's talk about the positive first. Oh, yeah.
let's talk about how good we are. Yeah. First.
Let's talk about the stuff we do.
Yeah, I mean, I'm the first to get on the roof and fix stuff
in the house.
Yeah. Oh, in the house. So yeah like plumbing stuff and like electrical.
Bro,
and,
why you got to be so like manly all the time?
Like build. I like to build stuff because I feel like I'm doing something substantial. You know, it's the little stuff that I have a hard time with, like, all the... It's the consistency.
Did you change diapers?
I'm very inconsistent.
Did you do a lot of diaper changes?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and that's what's so funny, like, because my dad and, like, his generation and all that used to give me all this shit about that, you know, like, I never had to touch, you know, diaper change and all that. I was like, well, you're fucking lazy. You know, like, that's nothing to be proud of. Dude. You know, like, I don't know, man. It's a different mentality.
When,
like,
when I was a kid, who was it? Was it my sister? It might have been my sister. She was a baby, and my mom went somewhere, and my dad, she pooped, and my dad freaked out. He's like, oh, what do I do? So he's trying to change her diaper, couldn't figure it out, and ends up using duct tape to tape the sides of the diaper. And my sister, classic. My other sister who's older, because I have three younger
duct
siblings,
tape
right?
Over everything.
I have three younger siblings. So the sister that's closest to me in age, she sees what my dad's doing, and she's a baby still. She's not a baby. She's still just a child, right? So she must be, I'm trying to think how far in age. She might have been 7 or 8. And my youngest sister was obviously a baby. And she goes over and she goes, Papa, you're doing it wrong. And she like pushes my dad aside. And she changed her sister's diaper.
That's great.
She did the whole thing. Yeah, my mom comes home. And now when I was a baby one time, my mom tells a story that she came home and I was just walking around naked in the house because my dad's like...
It's like, hey, man.
Yeah.
It's going to happen. It's going to happen.
Yeah, and he puts newspapers on the floor everywhere.
Newspapers.
Let him run around like,
like a little puppy.
Yeah, so what do you do, Adam?
Man.
He's all trying to change the subject.
No. Yeah. Katrina is... So I have a super wife at home. So she pretty much handles everything. Everything and anything. There's not much that Katrina does not handle. But being in fairness to myself, right? I'm sure she would defend me and be like, that's not true. You help out, blah, blah, blah. I think that she truly handles almost everything. She's, out of the two of us, she's the most organized. I'm the most scatterbrained. But what I think I am good at, and what I do is I'm very very aware, and I pay close attention to her mood and her day, and I know her schedule, so I know if she's had a long day, I know if she had a big meeting or she had something a lot on her plate, or you know if what she's doing for MP and stuff, if she's got a bunch going on. Like if I recognize these things that she does, then I try and pick up the slack where I know that she'll clean the house, she'll take care of the dishes, she cooks, she cleans, she does laundry, she handles all that stuff. I mean, we have house cleaners that come every 10 days, so you know, it's not like there's major, it's not like she's doing huge deep cleaning. But you know, she pretty much handles most everything, even to the extent of if cars need to be fixed, she's the one who sets the appointment. I typically go pick it up or take it there or pay for it or whatever, but she handles booking it and setting the calendar up for me. But what I do is I'll pay attention to, you know, what's going on in her life, and I'll relieve her of the things that she normally would do because I see she's carrying a lot, you know.
I'm always thinking like that because you just can see opportunities to kind of help, and I think that's the biggest thing. If like she's like frazzled from having the kids and they're in a certain kind of a mood, you know, I just take everybody and I leave and give her peace in harmony for a couple hours.
Right.
Or like, yeah, I mean, I definitely have gotten better. I've been bad about, you know, dishes and vacuuming and stuff like that. But I've really made an effort, a concerted effort to right after everything's done, just attack it and not even think about it. Just I'm talking and I'm doing stuff, and that's really helped. And I've been a lot more consistent with it. And it totally changes the atmosphere of the entire house.
Yeah, so. I try and do my best to be proactive. Of course, there are some times where and, you know, I could probably count on one or two hands and all the time we've been together where, you know, I could tell she was irritated with me because maybe I wasn't helping out enough around the place. So it doesn't take that much for me to notice when, you know, she's not her normal chipper self, or she's got a lot on her plate, or she's stressed. And, you know, the only time it's really tough is if we both happen to be going through it at the same time. And those are those times. If there's ever a time where she's just like, God damn, could you fucking help me?
Yeah.
And it kind of gives me that shit. It's because I've got a ton of stress in my life, a bunch of shit on my plate, and then she does too. So it's like, or else I would be on top. Yeah. And there's been a handful of times that, you know, that's happened. But in our relationship, you know, if she doesn't complain, she doesn't bitch, she doesn't ever do things like that. So if she does, then I know she's overwhelmed, and that's a lot, because it takes a lot to push her to that point where she feels the need to ask me, like, hey, dude, could you fucking help me out here with this stuff? I'm fucking buried in laundry. I've got this going on. I got to do this for you. I got to do that. And then it's like, my bad.
That's why I know exactly. It's almost the same thing, but it's all about like trying to get her to hang out with her friends and go do things that she enjoys, you know, outside. So it's not like... it's this identity of like, I'm just mom and I'm stuck here and, you know, and I'm just doing all this shit. And it's like, no, get out, enjoy yourself, do something. I'll just like take over.
You know? And I know for the other thing too, that I know that's really important in keeping a healthy home and healthy relationship for us is just, I've never trained myself like this until her to, be proactive about just little things like going out for a walk after dinner and doing shit. Like, I didn't do shit like that before. That wasn't a part of anything in a relationship that I had before, where I was like, you know, we can really easily get caught in the hustle and bustle of keeping the house, the bills going, the business going, all the stuff going on with both of us that, you know, and I know that stuff really goes a long way with her. And I think in just women in general is quality time and making the time to do something that is just kind of like, whatever for a guy, like go for a walk. Like this is not very much fun or very cool or very challenging, but just getting out of the house, walking down the road with her, you know, on a nice night or whatever like that. I mean, last night we did it with her mom. I know those things to her, like me doing that is so much more important than me, you know, folding the most recent laundry that just got done.
She listens to the show, right?
Yeah, every episode.
She's gonna get a text afterwards. Actually,
whatever, Adam.
Now that you're bringing
it up,
any of that. Why don't you do the laundry too?
She holds it down, man. No doubt. She's I've said it on the show before. She's the rock for sure. Yeah.
My wife doesn't listen, so I'm good.
Bring the chicken.
Today's Quaw is being brought to you by Chimera Coffee. It's the only coffee that is infused with all natural nootropics for a cleaner, calmer, and more focused buzz without the crash. Click the Chimera link at mindpumpmedia.com and input the discount code MINDPUMP at checkout for 10% off.
It's the motherfucking Quaw.
The eagle has landed.
Quee-quaw.
First question is from Keep Up With M. Way. How do each of you enjoy the holidays without compromising your health and fitness goals? How do you tweak your diet and fitness routines leading up to the holidays? And how do you sustain those routines through the holidays?
Yeah, the way I view holidays is, first and foremost, when you're talking about total wellness, health, fitness, all these different things, there are a lot of components that make that up. It's not just physical performance, although that's in there. it's not just, you know, body fat percentage and all that stuff, but that is in there. It's not just, you know, physical health. There's also mental health and emotional health. And some people would even say spiritual health. And that, you know, all of that is very, very important. There isn't one piece that's more important than the other. And if one falls down or if one is bad, it will take its toll on the others. And sometimes the others have to kind of, you know, pick up the pieces or support those other ones in supporting roles. So the way I look at holidays is holidays for me is really to feed my emotional health, the health I have with my connections with families and friends. So that's the priority. So Christmas comes once a year. Thanksgiving comes once a year. When I'm at those events and I'm with my family, I'm not thinking to myself about my fitness. I'm not thinking about my body fat percentage. I'm not thinking about any of that. What I'm thinking about is connecting with the people around me. Now, what you'll find when you go to your holidays with that mental, with that that understanding, or at least with that that concept, you may find, because this is what I find, when I would go to these holidays, understand this is about my family, I find myself eating less of the cookies and sugary stuff and the stuff that I know normally would bother me anyway.
Because you give yourself the approval to do that.
That's it. If I, when I was at like super hardcore into fitness, I would treat those holidays as like free for all.
Yeah.
And then it become it went over. I ended up
your way through.
Yeah, and I'd feel sick, and I'd feel, you know, my stomach would hurt, and I'd take a nap, you know, after dinner because I couldn't breathe or whatever. Now when I go there and it's like, it's about my family and friends, I'll enjoy a few things here and there, but it's not that big of a deal. And I enjoy them because someone made them homemade. I'm going to taste them. If it's not, if it's store-bought cookies, maybe not big deal, but I'm there to enjoy the people around me. And when I found that since I treat the holidays that way, it makes it a lot healthier physically as well. Ironically, very, very different than what it used to be. So,
I have a bunch of different things here because I've actually I competed 1 year the day after Thanksgiving. So I actually hopped on stage the day after. I was driving down to the competition on Thanksgiving Day, so I didn't even have a Thanksgiving 1 year. And I'll never do that again. I did it because I thought it was a smart strategy, and I was completely wrong. I thought, there's got to be nobody else. If you're a pro already, I thought all the top pros are at home.
There's no way.
Yeah, they're at home at Thanksgiving. Well, fucking 25 of them showed up with me.
Oh, man.
all thinking the same.
This is how we avoid it.
Bunch of fanatics.
Yeah, so I was totally wrong by that. I thought that was a really smart strategy. And
Do you feel like I missed that Thanksgiving with my family now?
Absolutely, I did.
Oh, man, that sucks.
Yeah, but I learned a lot, and there's certain things that I'll say that you know, this is how, like you, I agree, Sal. Like, so at that time, I made it work. I mean, fuck, could you imagine a more challenging time to compete at a competitive level than fucking Thanksgiving or during the holidays? I mean, that was very challenging and it was very doable. And I like to do things like that occasionally to stretch myself, to prove to myself that I have the discipline to, you know, refrain from going overboard on foods and do things during the times when everybody makes the justification of, oh, it's the holidays and I'm just going to fucking eat whatever. So I enjoyed putting myself through that to prove that I have the mental discipline. And so it taught me a lot about that. But with, like Sal said, you know, the holidays really are, you know, it's a time for me to enjoy with my family. And because I don't compete anymore, and I definitely remember sacrificing some holidays for sure and birthdays where I was in the middle of competition mode and I just didn't get to have anything really. I had to be in my Tupperware, eating in my Tupperware. And I didn't like that. And I would never want to do that long term. I don't give a shit about how important competing is to me or whatever at that time. Going forward, it would not be something that I would sacrifice. But there are some things that I do. Dude, I keep saying doo doo. I said doo doo. I said doo doo like two times today, didn't I? I just got
doo doo on the mind.
I'm noticing the same thing. I'm like, if I bring it up, it'll be so.
I know
you did, so it's all good. It's
like, I just caught it. I was like, why did it come out twice like that in one episode?
So much doo doo.
So I doo doo. What I doo doo is I will set up the day. Like, okay, so I know Thanksgiving, and most people I know for Thanksgiving, Christmas, all these holidays. Normally, the big meal comes around between noon and four, right? Somewhere in that range. So I like to make sure that I either get a really good lift or get out and do some fasted walking and cardio and burn off some and just refrain from food until the big feast is coming. And then if I just enjoy myself and I'm mindful while I do it, because I don't really think that people do as much damage as they think they do on the actual holidays.
No.
It's fucking all the spiraling down afterwards.
Yes.
People get so crazy about that.
Yeah, it's not like most people, I'll tell you what, especially if you do this, if you fast till the big meal and then you just fucking gorged. I mean, eat until they have to roll you out. What are you going to get, 5,000, 6,000 calories down?
Maybe not.
Yeah.
I don't know how many people that can do that.
Yeah, right. So you're not going to put on a pound or 2 pounds of fat from one holiday meal.
And calm down. Right. Like, really? You just shove all that shit in your mouth, like, just one sitting? Like, why don't you just eat like a reasonable person?
Right. So I think you could actually...
Good God.
I think you can actually really enjoy your holidays, enjoy, you know, all, and, you know, so I do little things, right? Like I do the walking thing, the fasting. I eat in the order of what's best for me. So when I look at
vegetables first?
Yeah, vegetables and meats first before I start going to the gravy and mashed potatoes and the breads. So yeah. I try and fill up on the things that are giving me the most value, but then I don't neglect my, like if there is a dish that I just love that one of my mom makes the most amazing, we have this recipe that's been in the family for 100 years and it's stuffing and it's amazing and I'm not going without it. It's like going in my plate for sure and I love her gravy. So, but I make sure that I eat the other stuff first and then I enjoy that and it's like, and then I get up the next morning and I don't start down the path that everybody does and have, you know, fucking the marshmallow yams for breakfast and then they wash it down with some fucking sugary drink.
Have you found that, like, you know, some of your filter is gone with being nice about certain foods? You know, like somebody like brought some Jello with a bunch of marshmallows on it and shit. I'm like, yeah, I'm not eating that. You know, like, it's like I'm not eating that. That doesn't interest me.
It's not even good.
Yeah.
My mom.
This is not salad.
Yeah.
So stop calling it salad.
My mom celebrates Thanksgiving on a different day because we have this blended family and she just finds it easier to, I think November 11th is our Thanksgiving with my family. And Katrina texts my mom and said, you know, what would you like? Would you like me to bring a dish or this or that? And my mom's still like, yeah, could you bring over a marshmallow salad or what's it called? It's called something like that, right? Know, yeah. Jello marshmallow salad or whatever. Yeah. And Katrina's like, I don't even know what the fuck that is. What does your mom want me to make? I'm like, she gave you Jello marshmallow salad. We're not going to eat that. Tell her no. I'll tell her.
It's a sugary dessert that identifies as a salad.
It's literally.
It's a new pronoun. Yeah, we're throwing it in there for Christmas.
Yeah, that one and then the sweet potatoes.
Dad doesn't have to deal with enough.
I'm just like, man, that's just candy. So, yeah, I think these are little things. This year, Katrina's family, we have a very, very competitive basketball family game that we play. So, and that's after we eat. So we'll eat and then do that. So honestly, I can pretty much go to town on that day as long as I'm mindful. The next days that follow, I think that's where people really get caught up.
Yeah,
is,
man, stay active.
Yeah, they have
a slug.
Yeah, enjoy the day, enjoy your family. But
That's it. Because if you go, the following days, if you're just gorging yourself, it's no longer about the holiday. It's no longer about the people around you and the family around you. And the people that tend to have the worst relationships with these holidays are the super strict dieters year round.
Yeah,
and they treat this like this. You know, like a binge
it's
on
the whole. Yeah, it's the whole cheat day mentality, and that's why you know you don't hear us talk about cheat days like ever on the show, really, except in a negative kind of context, because it's just this mentality where now everything, you know, all gloves are off, and I could just shove shovels of food down my face, and you know. Oh wow, weird! I gained 10 pounds this weekend.
Yeah,
I mean, I sat around and just fell asleep and didn't do shit.
Thanksgiving holidays and Christmas holiday, like the eating that goes on there, isn't that different than how I actually eat year round?
Right.
It's just that I actually get to have these amazing gourmet foods that my family make that are tradition, because I still do the same thing. Like, you know, I will periodically have low calorie days that lead up to a big calorie day, and I'll go enjoy a burger or something like that. That'll be like my high calorie day where I'm enjoying these foods that I wanted. And Thanksgiving is basically the same. I'll treat so
yeah, ramp up your metabolism so you can handle like some of this.
So I'm smart leading up to that. I'm typically the days leading up to Thanksgiving, I'm being very cautious of my calories and not over consuming leading into it. you know, fasting maybe that morning and moving around and being active. And then fuck, I'm enjoying the shit out of myself, man. I'm not saying no to anything that I really want to enjoy with my family while I'm sitting there eating.
Yeah. And you know, as far as fitness is concerned, your workouts, I mean, there's really no reason to stop working out. Just keep working out. It's funny that some people actually take that time off from their fitness as well. And I think those are the same people that view their training as a job or as a punishment, or, you know, because I don't stop working out because I enjoy it.
You know, that's a really good point because that's the other piece that really gets everybody. It's the combination of fucking off the diet and all of a sudden not lifting. It's like the worst thing you could possibly do. Like, if you actually just kept your training routine up and just was mindful that
you might make use of those extra calories. Right. Sometimes we have a tradition every Thanksgiving where the day after Thanksgiving, we have the post-Thanksgiving. We named this years ago post-Thanksgiving Guido workout.
Oh, are you going to do that this year?
Yeah, we'll do it next year.
Are you going to do it down here?
We might do it here or my garage.
You should do it here.
But
I always have to cut our tree. Yeah. The following
no,
day.
So me and my cousins, my brother, we all meet together. There's anywhere between sometimes four, sometimes many as seven of us, depending on who can make it. And the day after, we all meet together and we lift, and we lift heavy. We talk a lot of shit. It's a bunch of ego lifting and joking. And then we afterwards go and eat a meal together and have a great time. So it's like a day we get to hang out together. And it's funny, we've done it now for this maybe the seventh or eighth year in a row coming up. And everybody's wives and girlfriend are just like, yeah, it's okay. It's your guy time. You know what I mean? And it's cool. It's really, really cool. I look forward to it.
I missed out last year. You did it. I wanted to come. I remember we had to go do something. I think I had to get a tree or something at the same time. But I want you to do it down here so we could come down.
That'd be awesome.
Next question is from Mark Wolves. Thoughts about intra-workout foods and drinks?
You know that term intra-workout?
It's another made-up one?
Yeah.
You mean that made-up word?
Pre-workout, intra-workout, post-workout.
What's next?
Now we've sold you a supplement for before, middle, and after.
Yeah.
If we could only break
Inception.
Up the, if we could only break up the workout into quadrants. Then we have more. Second quadrant supplement, third quadrant.
The thought of working out, I have to supplement.
There are athletes out there, and there are types of training that may benefit from intra-workout supplementation. Intra-workout supplement is something you take during your workout.
Who, endurance athletes?
That's it.
I was going to say.
That's it.
Who the hell else is going to
That's
really
it. And really, it's only endurance athletes that are training, you know, that are doing really, really long runs.
Yeah.
And that's why they have those goos and those easily digestible carbohydrates or whatever.
The only other place I could see this, and I did this, and I didn't do it the healthy way when I was a kid, but if I'm being completely transparent here, so I used to drink rock stars, those sugar loaded ones, in the middle of my workout.
In the middle of your workout?
In the middle of my workout.
Yeah.
And the reason why, well, before my workout, I'd have about an hour or two before my workout, I'd have a full meal, then I'd have a bar or a quick shake, and then I would also eat the sugar drink in the middle of it. And this was during my heydays of trying as hard as I could to gain weight. And as a trainer and in my early 20s, I was burning 5,000-6,000 calories every day consistently. And so I just had a hard time keeping up with calories. So I tried to find anywhere I could get these this liquid sugar or liquid calories. And so instead of just drinking just pure water my whole workout, I would go back and forth between sipping on a Rockstar to drinking water. Now, I say that in complete transparency, but I'm not recommending that you do that. But that's the only other place where I get where somebody would feel the need to do intra-workouts is if you really struggle with getting enough calories in your diet. And
I almost feel like that would take away. I could see some sugar, but like food, you know what I mean? Or calories in the,
that would be tough to work out.
That would be tough, right?
Yeah, to eat.
I mean,
I did it because drinking would be easy.
Yeah. So here's the thing. If you want to drink something that's got flavor, like, I mean, you can do that. But again, you know, water is probably your best option. I haven't done anything. The Organifi green juice is pretty good. I could see maybe drinking that for a long workout.
I've done that, but not with the intention of trying to get something out of it, right? Like I actually enjoy the Organifi green juice. Like it's just a refreshing. It has that kind of minty flavor. It's, you know, I can put a lot of water in it and it really waters it down. Mm-hmm. And I've done that before where I'll do like literally you know, 32 to 60 something ounces of water.
So you dilute it.
Yeah, so it's diluted and it has kind of a minty flavor to it, and I'm getting my stuff from my Organifi. But I'm not like, it's not
because you're trying.
Right. I would not tell like a client who asked me like, hey, Adam, what do you think about Intra? And I'd be like, oh, take the Organifi green juice for your Intra workout and it's going to maximize your muscle gain. Like I wouldn't.
It doesn't make a difference.
No, I like it.
It's one of those categories of supplements. That's kind of a myth. Aside from the endurance athletes, you're not going to really benefit from taking anything during your workout. And I know there are supplement companies, I'll tell you, drink branched chain amino acids, prevents muscle breakdown during your workout. Like, here's the thing with individual amino acids. When you take high doses of individual amino acids or just three, like the branched chain ones, you can throw some things off in your body. And there is some evidence that high doses of branched chain amino acids has a depressive effect on some people. And it might not be good. So if you're drinking, because I know some people that drink branched amino acids all day thinking it's going to make them build muscle, and then they feel down, and they're wondering why they feel down. It might be the BCAAs, but otherwise, you're probably best drinking nothing, maybe not even water. You know, you're already hydrated. Go in your workout and just do your workout, unless you're doing these super long, grueling type workouts where you're going to have to, you know, replenish glycogen while you're training.
Those are like super long.
That's a long, that's like you're running 15 miles or 20 miles.
It needs to be over an hour because you're not even getting, you're not even threatening that. You could do high intensity
irrelevant
for almost an hour
otherwise.
Before you even
By the way, you know, you get a growth hormone spike from working out. And if you raise insulin, growth hormone drops. They're both inversely related.
So drinking something that's sugar,
having a bunch of carbohydrates in the middle of your workout, unless again you need the carbohydrates because you're doing this super long workout, like let's say you play like five basketball games in a row, that's different. But if you're lifting weights, you want to kind of take advantage of that growth hormone spike. It burns body fat, does build muscle. Drinking the sugary things is going to blunt that quite a bit, and you're going to get an insulin spike.
The irony too is a lot of times the kids that are drinking are the same kids too that are pounding the pre-workout before too. So you're like, I'm trying to gain weight, so I'm drinking this Intra shake workout, but then I'm also doing a pre-workout that's overstimulating my body before I go.
You're gonna need Gatorade to refresh me.
What a shit drink, by the way. I hate that they fucking parents give that to all the kids after soccer.
Great marketing.
I'm like, oh, it's terrible. But no, you got your stimulate before. Let's spike some cortisol, drink some sugar, you know, in the middle of it. So now we're going to spike up your insulin. Like, what a great combination.
It's hilarious. Yeah.
Next up is Jeff Sherman, 22. What's your guy's method for retaining information?
Oh, I forgot. I'm
punching myself in the head.
I used to have one.
Well, let's just say right out the gate, Sal's probably the best at this for sure.
Yeah.
I definitely think that
are your ways, wise one?
There is, I don't have... I don't necessarily have a method. It's if I'm really into something.
Did you notice where at what point in your life as growing up did you put together that like you had this ability to read something and then just remember it really well? Like when did someone finally tell you that, or did you put it together like that it was abnormally good?
Family members would be talking about a subject, and I would know something about that subject, and then everybody would look shocked. And they'd be like, how did you know that? And then my answer, and everybody used to make, they used to tease me about this because I used to always say, I don't know, I just know. Because I just did. I remember as a kid, I would know these things and I didn't piece it together that something I read earlier. As I got older, then I started kind of thinking about this because people started pointing this out to me quite a bit. And it's funny, when I remember something, I actually remember what it looks like. I can remember the page, how I read it and where it is. And I don't know if that's what helps me remember, or if it's because, you know, because when I really get into something, I get so focused on it that it just, you know, I just retain it very well.
Yeah, into your brain.
But I will say this, I do know, so maybe that's my default, right? Maybe that's my baseline. So my baseline may be higher than, let's say, the average person for remembering things, but I have found techniques or things that I can do that brings it up even higher, and nothing is as effective for retaining information for me than when I teach it. If I learn something and teach it or talk about it, I will remember it. It becomes something. Yep. And as a trainer, I learned this very, very quickly. I would read a topic, I'd read an article on carbohydrates or on gut health or on hormone or something like that. And because I was into that article, I would talk about it to my clients and teach it to people. And then that was it.
Well, not only that, to take that a step further, like refining that message even more to present to like a kid. So like, you know, just trying to explain natural things that in the world and that they have this curiosity about it and they're asking you like a legit question about it. And I'm like, oh my God, how do I explain this in a way that they're going to understand it? And it just, and then things click a little bit further for me. Like I just to get it to refine down to that level has really helped like certain subjects and certain things. Like I understand on a greater level that way.
I have a couple things. Sal nailed one right on the head for me for sure that, I wasn't even thinking about till you said that, and this couldn't be more true to me and my personality. And even to the point where I've actually been teased, made fun of this. It's even something that we make light of on the show all the time. What I will do anytime I learn something, especially if it like strikes a chord with me where I was like, oh, fuck, that's really good information, I will immediately regurgitate it. I will definitely say it, and a lot of times I say it and I fuck it up and it doesn't sound as good as the first person who gave it to me or the first time I read it, right? Because it's the first time that I've practiced saying it. It's like, I just read something, I learned it, I thought, wow, that was really good information. Right away, I try and challenge myself to whether I share it with Katrina or family or friend or on the show or whatever it may be, I'll share that information. And sometimes like it flows right out. I retained it really well. And then sometimes I don't. And sometimes it comes out and it's all kind of messed up, or I make up a word in there and it just doesn't flow right, just doesn't get processed.
It's all mixed up.
Right. And so what happens after that, like people would tease or make fun of me or give me a hard time about, and I don't let it bother me. And I think that's where a lot of people, they learn or they read something or they hear something and they got the information, but because they're not confident that they can give it the same way they received it or they read it, that they just keep it in there. And I think this is a major issue with bad communicators. I used to have really, really intelligent people that worked for me, PhDs, masters, brilliant minds, far smarter than I was. And it would blow my mind how poor of trainers they were. Mm-hmm. Because I thought, like, how does this guy who works for me, who has a much higher education and experience than I do, can't do as well at this job as I can when he's got way more information because he couldn't get it off his tongue.
Yeah.
He couldn't communicate.
I'm going to be honest. I mean, I feel like I'm a little bit slow to the party as far as like having to communicate verbally, like what I know. And that's been a real source of friction for me is starting this podcast and like getting it like, cause I could on a one-on-one level, I can coach and I can cue and that's like my comfort zone. And like even going through the academic process though, like I knew exactly what I had to do study wise, like look for on the test, I would scan and it was like I gamed the whole way that I would learn because of what I expected to see and do well and excel based off of what they were like quizzing me on. Mm-hmm. And so like some of my methods for school were totally different than what I do now. Like, I mean, for me to retain things, I would study till whatever I was like memorizing late at night, I would repeat it over and over and over and over and over. And then first thing in the morning, I'd look over it once and then boom, I had it. But I didn't retain it. Yeah. So, you know, it's...
You learn how to learn it just long enough to be
just
able to
long
it.
Enough. Yeah.
And a lot of people do that. I think what we're really talking about right now is that, and I think this is generally true for most people, is that humans tend to learn well through discussion. Mm-hmm. And this is probably because we evolved our ability to communicate verbally way before we ever evolved the abstract idea of symbolism and writing of, you know, and writing of and reading, mm-hmm. which is extremely abstract. People don't realize how abstract of a concept and what a mind-blowing concept that was for a human to, you know, we drew pictures for a long time, but to write a symbol and to assign it a sound so that you can combine different symbols together to create a word,
that is an
extremely brilliant, abstract way of thinking that obviously propelled mankind forward, but it came much further along. Before that, it was all through discussion and song. Song mm-hmm. is the other thing. One of the reasons why...
They call it mnemonic learning?
Yeah, or? I mean, think about this, like... You can remember a fucking jingle or a song and know all the words to it.
Yeah.
way easier than you can if you were just to read that list of words or whatever and without a tune behind it.
Dude,
way,
I used
way
to
easier.
Do that all the time, especially for organic chemistry. Like, I would have to literally like sing a lot of the compounds like in my head so I could remember it, because it was just like it, just so many different things for me to just memorize. Like, I was terrible at memorizing things, yeah. But that totally helped.
It all goes back to evolution, and we evolved passing on information through song and through discussion.
Do you ever
and so if you want to retain information and you want to use hacks, like real hacks, these are real hacks. Like, if you talk to memory experts, these are real things, is use song and discussion. And so I think when we're talking about how we learn it by teaching it, really it's discussion, right? It's a discussion that's causing
survival. I've had great success recently with the advice that I took from Tom Bilyeu. And every time I do it, it trips me out that listening to audiobooks at a faster speed actually helps me retain more. I would never think that.
You pay closer attention.
It seems like it would be totally opposite, that speeding the words up would make it annoying and hard to listen to and not be able to absorb it all. But because it's so fast, I can't be distracted by other things. I have to completely hone in and focus on what's coming in, mm-hmm. because it's coming in so fast. But it forces me to hang on every word and repeat it in my head really quick, and then I tend to retain so much of it. Where it now, if I listen in a one speed and it's just like the speed of us talking right now, I can trail off because I feel like
you're thinking about other stuff.
Yeah, I can listen and think about other stuff, which I feel like because of that, it takes away from the information that I'm listening to. So that was a big hack for me that it has helped me out, but. 100% the after you get information, sharing it right afterwards. And I think...
It would be, if you're in college, like you can even literally read a chapter and then call your friend and or your girlfriend or your boyfriend and
share what you just learned.
Yeah, just talk to them about what you just read, which won't take you very long, 15 to 30 minutes, but it's...
It'll blow you away.
It'll blow you away how much more effective it is than the old way of, you know, trying to write things down and take notes.
For sure, this is me all the way. Like, that's how I've had... And then, like I said, you're going to fuck it up sometimes and it's not going to come out. Like, you just can't let that make you feel insecure because, oh, it didn't sound perfect or I forgot this stat or like that. It's like, you know, sometimes when you practice, you know, sharing information after you've just learned it, sometimes
fleshing it out.
Yeah. And what I would do is every time I would do that, right? Cause it's inevitable that's going to happen. I'm going to read something that's kind of, maybe it's a heavy topic and I'm going to miss some things. Mm-hmm. Then that makes me want to go dive back into it. Right. So I share it, mess a few things up, make me go back, relearn it again. And then by that time it's like, it's completely.
The other thing too, I want to touch on before we even move to the next question is, when it comes to retaining information, sometimes you have to make space for new information. Mm-hmm. And I don't mean you need to forget something else, literally, like, you know, I got to erase, you know, my brain so I can. But what I mean by making space is if your mind is preoccupied with, anxiety or stress, and you're having repetitive thoughts about something, or you're just stressed out about the day or whatever, if you can't handle that, it'll be very difficult for you to remember anything. So sometimes sitting quietly, meditating, going for a walk, doing things that kind of make space will help you retain the information.
I wonder if we all have this individual ability.
Well, and walking too really helps me.
That's actually a good idea. Actually.
Yeah, moving.
Yeah, moving and doing stuff is actually
huge.
Yeah, because I was talking to somebody and they were talking about how when you're moving your body, you're preoccupying certain parts of your brain, and it allows the other parts to be more open and free to remember. And that's why it's a creativity tool. You ever notice how you come up with some of your best ideas while you're doing things or moving?
Mm-hmm.
Same thing.
I was fascinated with, I just read not that long ago in this new book that I'm reading, Subliminal, about that 95% of the information that we download in the day is actually subconscious and we don't even realize it. Like, so that's 95%, dude. That's so most of the information our brain is downloading and processing, it's subconsciously happening.
You are literally, this freaks me out, but you are literally living in a tiny piece of what's really happening.
Right. I know. That's so
you're not even processing it. Like, I bet you we don't even see like a fraction of what's in front of us.
No, not at all. I mean, right now there's a part of my eye that's looking at something over the left. Right now it's downloaded that information and it's processed.
There's a guy in a clown suit like the whole time.
Right there. Well, it's
fuck.
It's pretty crazy, but yeah, shit's happening all around you and you're so unaware.
Well, this is my,
you're living in a dream.
This is my theory on why when you go places like Yosemite or you go to these like what they say take your breath away type scenery places,
it's just like overload.
Well, it is. It's how often are you in a space where from completely everywhere from the left to the right to the top to the bottom
you're paying attention
and you're downloading beauty. Like, that's just rare when you think about it. That's what makes, I think, the take the breath away part, because we're so used to like this, the scene that we're sitting in right now. Okay, we got 600 and something episodes deep in this. I've seen Doug over there a million times. I've seen you there. I've seen all these things in here. So it's not take your breath away. It's like I've already downloaded and processed.
Sometimes I'm wearing something that might take your
spice
breath
it up, Justin. Yeah.
Right? Come all on, right, man.
That's, I take that as a challenge, actually.
Next question is from Get Fit with Miranda. What advice would you give to a new gym manager with regards to training trainers? Do I go in and change the way they train, or do I introduce them to MAPS programming and hope they take from it, allowing them freedom?
So a new gym manager, yeah, this freedom.
This is a tough question right here.
Very tough question, because on one hand, when you first walk into a gym, you need to set the tone immediately.
Fire everybody.
No, you need to set the tone immediately, because
I used to say that
when you first walk into a gym or a business or you're managing
your own culture,
and you're all of a sudden like this super nice, and I'm going to be very hard to be an asshole after that. Very hard to get hard after that. If you walk in and you're like, all right, here's the deal. This is what's happening. There's a it afterwards. You can throw that out every once in a while. You can bring that up. But the other side of it too is you want to develop a good connection with these people. You want to earn their trust. Now with trainers, really, if you want to spend a lot of time with them in ways that are going to see that they're going to see a huge impact in how they train and how they build their business, you're going to focus a lot of time on how they communicate, far more than how they train. However, it is important. I used to notice this as a manager. I did 10 meetings a month with my trainers. It would be, you know, I don't know, 6 would be on communicating better and organizing your business and all that stuff, but 4 would be on better training. And the reason why I would put those four meetings for better training was, of course, I want to teach my trainers, but because they loved it. That was the second one. They didn't necessarily get a huge amount out of it like they would, at least if they were good, like they did with the communication, but I did it because trainers love those meetings. Trainers are usually, you have them come in and you're going to talk about communication. They're like, I don't care. I just want to train people. So those are my pieces of advice.
I'm gonna be a little bit different. I'm gonna tell you to fire everybody. I'm fucking serious too. And I wish I remember what book I can give you.
They're gonna get fired. They're gonna get themselves fired the next day. But Adam said to fire the whole staff.
Let me tell you. I wish I remember the book to
reference. You have to do that sometimes.
I'll try. Well, most times, matter of fact, 90% of the time, you will have to fire. And here's the deal. And that's so tough to tell somebody who's going into the position you're going into right now, because of course, that sounds scary as fuck to go in and handle a facility and then you're going to let go of everybody. And obviously, you can't fire everybody on the same day right away. But eventually, more than likely, if you're going to be very successful at what you're doing, they'll all end up probably being your people down the road. And think of it like this. And I don't know if you're a parent or not. I'm not, but I can still give this analogy. That coming into a gym, and this is something I'm very familiar with, in adopting somebody else's staff, is like being a mom or a parent and taking on 15, 17-year-olds that are somebody else's kid. That's what you got. You just inherited 15, 15-year-olds that were somebody else's kid, and now you got to teach them life. And imagine, is it possible? Sure, there's some people that were cut out for that. There are some people that could take somebody else's children, a whole bunch of them with different personalities that you didn't raise, and get them midway through their life and actually make an impact on them. I absolutely think that's possible, but it is fucking rare. And the likelihood of it is very small. Most of them they are going to have what they have learned from the manager before and potentially before that, that has really shaped and formed them into the trainer they currently are right now. And that is really tough to do when you're coming in to lead a facility and you want to create your own culture.
So, and for the first half of my career, I didn't do this. The first half of my career, I came in and I could outperform the guy or girl before me because I just had this ability to come in. I had a lot of energy. I was really talented at at my own job. And I basically had this idea of I'm going to come into this club and I'm going to run so fast. These trainers have never seen a boss before run at this level. And there'll be a few that will be inspired by it and they'll jump on board with me. And then together, the three or four or five of us would crush goal and we would have a successful business. And then the rest of them would eventually weed themselves out. Or I would end up self-imploding because I'm just trying so hard to carry this this entire thing on my back. It wasn't until later in my career, and I can't remember what book it was that made the difference for me, where I suggested that, you know, if you're going to be successful, they've got to be your people and your culture. And it was one of the scariest things I ever did was to come into a facility and fire. And I didn't do it on one day. I ended up letting go. I had 20-something trainers, and I got rid of 15 within the first 3 months that I was there. And I kept the major solid four or five that, you know, definitely got scared when they saw people getting let go of. And I had a rough month or two because I'm understaffed. But we didn't really take that much of a dip. It was pretty surprising for how much I cut as far as staffing was. We still maintained about the same revenue they were doing without the 15 trainers. And then once I got my people that I hired, that I trained, then it was so much easier to run the facility. So I know that sounds harsh to come in and do that, but the sooner you get your people and the sooner they're yours and you, because imagine
now,
if you,
but we got to give them some advice on how to make that manageable, because you can imagine someone walking into a gym, it's owned by someone else.
Right.
Maybe they can't fire everybody.
That sucks.
Yeah. So, but what you can do usually is replace them. And what I mean by that is bring some on board,
yeah,
and then slowly bring others.
Right. Start actively, yeah.
You know, you're looking for the replacement.
Which that should be right away.
Yeah, start recruiting.
If I'm being handcuffed by upper management, which I've been in this situation too, where you're kind of new and they're not going to let you come in. They think you're crazy. You're going to come in and fire everybody. And they're saying, no way you can do that. Then like Sal said, I'm out looking for everybody's replacement right away. I'm not, and I think this is a mistake that managers make when they come in, is they come in, they try and mold the staff that's currently there and change them and motivate them and get them to run, instead of running their programs, now they're running maps. It's like you're going to get people that hate you for that. Yeah. They're going to push back on you. Trainers have major egos. So trying to tell some smart trainer how he's going to program or how she's going to program, you're looking for a lot of pushback.
They'll get a lot of, you know, what's going on based off of that. Like, you're putting all this attention into these new trainers you're bringing in, and you're really taking your time to develop what kind of a culture you want with this person, and they'll see that and they'll watch it, because like you said, it's not something that people that are already there that have their own way of doing things, it's such an ego-driven job for the most part that a lot of these guys are going to give like nothing but pushback the entire time. So just kind of build your little army, and then you never know, you might actually get some of those like smart trainers that will see what you're doing and start contributing.
Do you remember that you went through this with me? So when I hired you, you and Nick at Hillsdale, and I took Nick, you, and Karan, is that all? And Ronnie, right?
Yeah.
Nick, you, Karan, and Ronnie.
Well, Ronnie came later, but yeah, he was hurt.
I took all four of you from Hillsdale with me to Santa Teresa, and that was it. I had four people that were mine, that were all people that I hired, trained, and developed from the beginning, and Justin was part of this. They then put me over in Santa Teresa, so it's a brand new club. They had like 15 trainers. I'm coming over with four of mine.
Yeah, and you hired like 10 of their trainers.
And
right?
what ended up the staff that was killer, were any of them left? I don't think we had none of them left.
Like maybe one, but yeah.
And what we ended up doing was just I came over, so I already had four that kind of knew my philosophy, that had my culture, and I then slowly started to get rid of all the other
trainers.
Yeah,
now that I think about it, I definitely would fire at least two or three. That was probably the average. Two or three walking into a gym. But, you know, I was a GM for a lot longer than I was an FM. So I'd have these big staffs, and I would place pressure on the FM sometimes to make some of those decisions, who's the fitness manager, to get rid of the trainers. Because as a GM, I had to be careful sometimes with how you take away, you know, some people's powers. And if you did have a good another good leader in your gym. Like if I had you, shit, man, that would have been an amazing team, because now you've got you know, some powerful leaders in the gym. It wouldn't be a problem. But you know, one thing I used to do when I used to train the trainers for training or for exercise is it wasn't so much. Sometimes it'd be a seminar, but it would be something that I would teach that I knew that they'd never heard of. But other times it was a discussion, and we'd sit down and I'd have a trainer that I knew was really good at whatever, whether it be Olympic lifting or correctional exercise, and they would teach the class, and then people would learn and listen. And
I mean,
and then you would see some excitement come out of that. But
if I could go back and be in her shoes, I think it was a girl, right? In her shoes, and
Miranda.
My mind pump existed, 100%. This is what I would do. Totally do this, because there's no way I'm going to be able to come into a staff of trainers and tell them how they're going to program their clients. They would fucking throw a fit. Like, talk about shaking their world upside down and getting a lot of enemies right away. But if that's my desired outcome, like if my true desired outcome is I do want all these trainers teaching maps because I do know it's superior and the clients will get more results, how do I go about that? Well, what I would do, and especially since you're a listener, is when you come across episodes that really strike a chord or that really make a lot of sense to you, and we convey that message really well or potentially better than how you could potentially convey it to your clients, is I would assign it. I was like, I would assign listening to it. And then I would say, hey, you guys, here's an episode. I want you a podcast episode. We have a meeting next Friday. If everybody, sometime between now and then, listen to the...
And then we'll discuss it.
And then we'll discuss it.
Perfect.
Right? And then then you have an open discussion about it. Then it's, you know, then if they, what you're doing is you're empowering them.
And you're also stimulating growth.
Right.
Because now everybody's discussing fitness. They're talking about concepts. They're talking about, you know, different ways of training people, and you're going to have some debate amongst your trainers.
Right.
And it's going to get everybody just to kind of, you know, grow from there.
So
learn from there.
And that strategy reminds me of one that I did probably 8 years in or so into my career. And we had what we used to call a fitness budget, where I was allocated, you know, $5,000 a month of revenue that I could spend on my trainers, which what we call floor hours, where they would walk the floor and try and book people. Well, you know, the idea is that $5,000 of floor hours would then convert into $10,000 of new business if I manage my staff correctly. And so at this time, I was really focused on education in my facility, because I had just recently seen a stat in the company that for every national certification that a trainer got, that what do you call that? How long they stayed in the company for?
The retention.
Yeah, their retention in the company was, you know, it would, every national cert added 1 to 3 years. Yeah. And if they had three national certifications or more, which would consider them back then a master trainer, their amount of revenue they produced, the amount of hours they served, it was so mind-blowing to me. I was like, how did this information just now make its way to me?
I remember when you did that and how powerful that was, because now what you're doing is you're emphasizing like how they can improve, be better. But also, like, one thing I did remember when, you know, you're managing us was just always pointing out like holes of where you could be making money and monetizing off of that. And that was one of those things. Like, if you had, you know, X amount of certifications, now you're at this level pay grade. And right. It's just like, it was like a no brainer, you know, like, but a lot of these trainers, they just get into their own little, you know, like, they create their own environment. They don't like consider all these different ways to maximize what they're doing in there. So, yeah.
So I literally paid the trainers to study, which was totally against the rules. I wasn't supposed to be able to do that. But
if you think about it, though, why not?
I know, right? Yeah, so that's right. I mean, the business mind of mine, I'm going like, it makes total sense to do this because it's going to be worth it. You know, so
totally fireable. Offense?
Yeah, right.
For reals?
No, absolutely.
Yeah,
100%. I mean, that's silly. Obviously, I made
in a corporate. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah. No, in a corporate setting, I could have easily been. If that was anybody else, I'm sure they could have got fired for that same situation. So I'm not telling you to go do something to get you fired. The point of the story, though, is what an impact it made. And my desired outcome was to get them all more educated. Had I gone about it by saying, get your national certifications, which I had been preaching that for years before, nobody did it. So what I did was I provided a place every Friday, and it was 2 hours. And I had two of my trainers that were already master trainers. They both had their degrees. They all had three national certifications. They taught the other trainers than first level of certification. And then after they got the first level, then they taught the second level. And so it was them teaching each other and learning and getting paid to learn and get themselves paid more. And it just, after that staff, we were unstoppable after that. That was probably...
That's team building right there.
Huge.
Absolutely. Check it out. Go to YouTube. Subscribe to our YouTube channel, Mind Pump TV. We post 365 videos a year.
Holy
smokes. Oh my gosh.
Nobody comes close. Also, if you go to mindpumpmedia.com, we offer 30 days of information, of fitness information for free. We call it 30 days of coaching. Go check it out.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic. 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.